Well, good morning. Welcome back. The second day of the Windows 8.1 UX Jumpstart. My name is Martin Tierian. I'm a user experience evangelist with Microsoft in the Netherlands. And with me is Chris.
Hi, I'm Chris Mayo. I'm also a user experience evangelist here at Microsoft.
So yesterday we already covered a number of topics. We talked about the general patterns we have for designing apps in Windows 8. With the Less is More session, we talked about the focus in your app and what makes your app great, right, and which scenarios and features you need to do that. We looked at the UI controls that are available to using your app and to get that experience. We talked about things like navigation and layout, so how to navigate through your app and how to lay out the controls, so you still have to focus on what the user thinks is important. And we talked about windowing, designing for various sizes and various DPIs.
Right.
This is today's agenda. We start with contracts and especially search in the first session. After that, we go to the share contract and how you can use that in your apps. We'll talk about contacts and appointments. That's new in Windows 8.1, how you can integrate that in your apps. After that, we'll focus on start tiles, notifications, and the lock screen, how you can make use of that to bring your app alive in the Windows environment. We'll have a session about the Windows Store, how you can make your app available to a wide audience and also make money from it. What are the options there? And then we'll have lunch, and after lunch, there's the last session with some experiences from apps that we created at Microsoft. So you can also learn from those experiences and know what you can face when you're building apps and how you can have an eye for detail. So that's the agenda for today. To start off, we want to start with talking about contracts. This is a special thing in Windows 8, where it's made possible for you to integrate into the system and integrate with other apps. So this is some basic understanding. And the reason for this is that your app, when you're building your app, you have this set of scenarios and features you want to implement, but you cannot implement everything in your app because, well, you don't have the time and the resources, and otherwise you have to bloat the app with all kind of functionality. So when you can make apps work together, you can add some functionality to another app, or another app can be used to add functionality to your app. So that's very beneficial for the user because he's in control and he can select which apps to use to combine together and have a complete end-to-end experience. Now, what are the things that you can do with contracts? There are the charms, of course, in Windows 8. So we have the search and the share and the settings and devices. And you can be part of that experience in your app. The charms offer a consistent UI to the user. So they always know where the search is or where the share function is. Or if they want to go to settings of an app, they know where it is. So that's a very easy for a user to find that kind of functionality, and you can just use that through using contracts in your app to integrate with that. So your settings can also be reached through that settings button, or you can share from your app through that share button in the charms. Another way to use contracts is to work together with other apps, as I explained before, and we'll look at some details of that as well. And there's a way to extend Windows and to be part of the Windows UI and integrate your app into that experience. When we look at the charms, so we talked about share, search, devices, settings, you can integrate there, but also things like file open or file save picker. It's given to you by Windows, and you can just integrate it in your app so you can select files or write to the file system. Play to is another one where you can play to other devices, for instance, to an Xbox and play videos to an Xbox. Contacts, appointments, and we see more of that later in the session. but you can integrate that through using contracts. Extensions is another thing where you can integrate with the experience of the operating system. For instance, when your app is playing audio, playing a radio station, for instance, you don't want to look at the app all the time. You want to continue with your work. And maybe your app is in the background. Now you can make use of the audio extension so your audio is still playing and the user can easily adjust the volume or go to the next song, for instance, just by using the OS UI for that instead of just using your app. So there's a whole list of things you see here in the slide that you can do, things like camera settings or background tasks. All these things are available to you to extend the OS. There are some resources if you want to know more about this. And again, some of these things will come back in the next presentations. But there's on the Design Center, there's a link where you can find more on charms, contracts, and capabilities. And also on the Dev Center, you can also find information there how to implement those contracts and extensions. And there are also a number of samples you can use to get yourself familiar with that kind of technology and how to implement it. And in most cases, it's just a few lines of code and it's integrated into your app. So those are the basics of extending the OS or working with other apps through contracts. Now, one of the important contracts in Windows 8 is search. And search changed from Windows 8 to Windows 8.1. And we'll go through those changes and why that is and how you can make use of it in your app. Now, the goal of search is to provide a very fast and efficient way to get to the answer the user is looking for. So he already has the question and he knows what he's looking for, but he doesn't know where it is or what the details are. And search is just a means to get very fast to that answer. And so that's one of the principles, fast and fluid. That's also very important in search and how that's implemented. There's a standard implementation in the operating system itself, in Windows, but you can also apply the same rules in your app and make use of that. So let's first look at how search worked in Windows 8. In Windows 8, when you go to the charms bar and go to search, this is what you would see on the right-hand side. So at the top, you can just enter some text. And then you can search in apps, or you can search in settings, or you can search in files. And you can even search in an app. So here I'm in the travel app. And when I go to the search charm, just by typing, it gives me some hints from the app. And the result is also showed in the app. So that was the complete experience in Windows 8. Now, what we learned from users and from our own use of Windows 8, it was very good that search is always there. You can always reach it from any screen. You can go to search and search wherever you like. And also the launching of apps and finding that information was very fast. So users really love this kind of behavior. What was found less efficient is that you always need to scope. So we saw that there was the text field, but then you had to scope for finding in apps or finding in files or settings or in a particular app. So you had always had to rescope because the default was most of the time not the thing you wanted. And another problem was that it's too high level. So it's just a text box there. So, for instance, I worked with a company who has a travel app, and they want more information, not only the name of a city, but also the dates and with how many people you want to search for a room. So they wanted to add metadata to that, and that was not possible in the search charm. So these were some of the things that user found were less efficient with search in Windows 8. So let's see how search changed in Windows 8.1. What's new in Windows 8.1 is that we have a smart search now. Smart search is part of Windows, and that's the searching on the web, actually anywhere, on your system. So this is provided by Windows, and we'll see it more in detail. We already saw some use of it by Chris yesterday in the demos. We'll go more into depth there. And the other new thing in Windows 8.1 is the search box control. This is a new control that can be used for in-app search. So you have the same experience that Windows is offering inside of your app. So let's start with smart search, the thing that's part of the operating system. And it's easiest to explain just by demoing it. So there are a few ways you can go to your search. That's still the same, right? Only there's a new shortcut. When you have a Windows flag S, it opens the search charm. And of course, you can also just open the charms and go to search, and you see the same. So now you see that the interface is more clean. There's the text box there, and it just says everywhere on top of it. So let me, for instance, start looking for sports. Now you see I just typed SP, and you already added orts and find the sports app there. So it's a very easy way for me to find the apps and fire it, because if I just press enter now, it starts up the sports app. So a very fast way of finding the app in this case. Or another example, when I open it, and now I start searching for Adele. I have the one of the her records on my machine, so just by typing it, I can find it and just start playing the CD in this case. Or maybe I want to find more detailed information. Let's try, for instance, the Microsoft stock. So it opens the finance app and now shows immediately the stock. And what happened there is when I go to the start screen, I have MSFT pinned to my screen. So that was a very fast shortcut to start it like that as well. Let me do the same query again on Adele and just execute it. Now what you see here is on the left-hand side, it shows the same files that are already on my system. So I can open it or play it, and of course it will open with an app. But when I scroll more to the right, you see that there's a hero section here. And there's an image, and it has some details about the artist in this case. I can play top songs with Xbox Music. I can read about her in Wikipedia. I can follow on Twitter, see some songs here, see some videos. I get some images here. So when I start scrolling, you see more and more content is showed. In this case, you see some CDs with that can be opened with Xbox Music. And here you get the web links. So there's more information here. And you see that the web links are not just a piece of text, maybe an abstract of that page, but there's actually a screenshot of the page. So you have more visual idea of what that information is and if it's the right information for you. So there are a lot of details here when I can scroll through this. Now you see that there are these are all web links. So this is through Bing and all that information is here, but with some of those links, you see, for instance, with Adele on Wikipedia, there's also a Wikipedia link at the bottom. Now, when I open that one, it opens the Adele Wikipedia article, but in the Wikipedia app. So there's integration here with search and the app. And we'll talk about how that's made possible in a few seconds. So this is a very powerful use of search in the environment. And you see that the focus is on searching on everywhere. It turned out that in Windows 8, only a few percent of the population of the users were actually using the rescoping, and most of the people just wanted to search like everywhere on the web or files, etc. So that changed in Windows 8.1.
It's really powerful when you look at that example of launching the app from the search hero. I mean, me as an app designer, I always want to have an app that's compelling, that my users love, and then I want to work really hard to get it in as many people's hands as possible. And
yeah,
we'll talk about how to do that with the store later today, but just implementing those appified web results within my app, I mean, my app can show up like the Wikipedia app, and that's just another great way. Someone's searching for information about San Francisco, Fits in the Tantrums, Adele,
yeah,
and my app shows up. If the app's not on the machine, they click that link, it's going to take them to the store to install it.
Just exactly.
A huge opportunity for you to get your app in more people's hands.
Yeah.
And showing great results in that search hero is going to make you know, make them kind of compelled to try your app out and see if it's just as great as those results that are returned. You know?
Exactly.
Yeah.
And what you also see in Windows 8.1, in Windows 8, there it was very, when you opened up an app and you closed it, you always came back to the start screen.
Right.
And now Windows is more smart with that. So that also makes it easier to just use Windows flag S or something like that to go to the search and go to that app, because when I close it, I'm back where I were instead of just going to the start screen.
Right.
So those are really advantages that makes it easier to find that information and get very fast to the answer you were looking for.
Even typing to search from the start screen. Like every once in a while, I'll just start typing to find an app or a file or something on my machine. And if I'm working with somebody that hasn't seen that before, they're like, how did you do that?
Exactly.
It's just like that type to search feature is just, blows people away.
It's just to show what Chris means. When I go to the start screen and just start typing here, the same happens.
Yeah.
So this was just Windows flag and typing, and it opened here.
Yeah.
So those are very easy ways of navigating through the system using search. Okay, smart search. So how do apps fit in? How does it all work? What you see here are the different parts that made up of that you see in the Windows in the search results. So first there's the hero page. This is beautiful image with this highlight of information that also differs if you have an artist or a city. So you have some different information here. This is provided by Windows. This is provided by the system. So you cannot integrate here. You cannot get your app to be linked from this area unless you can work together with the Windows team directly on that. The second is app mapped web results. That's what we saw with the Wikipedia link, where there was the Adele page, and I just opened the Wikipedia app to look at that kind of information. A third part of what you can find here is the store answer. So what you see here is that from your search result, it will also search the store if there are any apps with that word or name of text in it. So you can find those apps as well. And of course, then your app will show up there as well. And fourth is the search contract answer. If you look for this currently, it's not in the current version of search. That will come in the next updates, but now it's not there. So, but this is the meaning of getting all that information in the smart search screen. So how can you participate? Now, again, the hero integration, this is done by the Bing team. So it's not extensible today. There's not really a way to get into that integration. But there's more with the app mapped web results, and we'll show some details how to get in there. The link there is actually through web results. So you're looking for web pages, and there's information in the web page that tells Windows how to launch an app with what kind of information. So there's some work that need to be done there to make this really work. And of course, there's also always a delay, because if you have information now, it needs to be crawled first before you see it in the web results, of course. The search contract answer, that's implemented through the Windows 8 search contract. As I said before, that's not currently visible. It will be soon. And the fourth one is the store answer. This is just a search in the Windows Store for apps with that name, so your app can pop up there as well. So if you want to enable app-mapped web results, like we see with the Wikipedia example, there's a program for that. You see the link here that you can contact for registration. And what you really have to do, you have to enable your app to be launched with parameters, so it can immediately go to that type of information. So this is some technical registration you need to do where you need to handle the unactivated and launch of the application kind launch to use to know what happened, why you get fired, why you get loaded, and where you have to go in your app. Now, there are two ways to pass on that information from the smart search result to your app. And there, the two options are very good described in the next slides. So there, one is mapping rules. So that means that through that program, the definition is if there's a trigger of this URL, that's the trigger to load up your app. And this is the parameter that the team needs to, or Windows needs to take from that URL and pass on to your app. So that's a way. So in this example, there's a fabricum.com articles, article ID, blah, blah, blah. So that 342561 is the argument that's passed to the app. So the app can be loaded and you show that article in this case. Another option is to put meta tags in the HTML page that was crawled by Bing. So there are some meta tags here you can add, and that will say this is the app I need to that needs to be loaded, and this is the ID that needs to be loaded. So Windows knows what to do with that kind of information. Now this will not work automatically. If you just put it in your HTML page, your app won't show in the smart search results. Still, this is something you need to do through that program and the mail link that I provided in a few slides ago. So that's smart search, part of operating system, and you can be part of it as we mentioned. Now the next step is the in-app search. So how can you provide your search results in your app and the search experience? Now for that, I'll open up the search again and go to my mail app. And there it is. You see there's all kind of mails here. And you see there's also a search glyph. So that's with the inbox. When I just tap it, it opens up and there's the search box there. So I can find for anything. So let me find for Bing, for instance. And it will just filter on those items in my mailbox. And there's also an option at the bottom that says search in all folders, because I can have multiple subfolders and it will search that mail as well. But you see at the top, there's also the possibility to provide that information upfront. So when you start searching, so let me just close the search. I'm back here again, just do the search here. I can also start by saying I want to search immediately in all folders and then search for Bing and get the results. So this is a combination of using the new search box control in combination with some other controls where I provide more information for scoping the search and get more fine-tuned results immediately without doing extra steps. So these are some ways to use the control in your app.
This is really, I mean, an awesome change for me as an app designer. Before, it was kind of like I could search in the app, and now I can actually build in-app search, but still get that same kind of that comfortable, familiar feel of search in Windows, like yep. The query results, the app results, and the search history and stuff like that. So, yeah, I mean, even being able to apply that search specifically to different folders and stuff like that, or like your example for travel, being able to apply it to dates and how many people and stuff like that. Yeah, it's a great story. I get like all yep. The great Windows search features, but I apply them in my app or
in
to
my app.
Yeah,
exactly. And of course, that doesn't mean that the search contract from the search pane went away. We'll come back to that in a few slides. But this is the preferred way to have a very good experience of search inside of your app. Now let me go to the reading list app. And when I open that, you see the same search glyph on the right top of this app, but I can just start typing. Just by typing in letters, it immediately filters this kind of information. So you see I can use this also with a type to search and get very fast to my results in this page. I will talk about how that works in a minute as well.
It always surprises me when people are surprised by this feature. Like they either haven't tried it or don't know about it on the start screen, or they assume that that's something specific to the start screen or specific to Windows. It's an awesome feature they built into that search box that you can just, like from any list page, just start typing and start filtering. And
exactly.
Again, it's one of those things as a designer I have these scenarios I'm really excited about that I think are compelling. and whatever I can do to make those scenarios easier for the user to get to and complete. Yeah, it's the greatness of my app, right? It's that getting back to that great at statement.
Exactly. And think also of fast and fluid. So it's a very fast way to get to your answer and start reading the article or whatever it is that the information is in your app.
Yeah, because people will start off browsing, and then as they get more sophisticated with the app and start understanding the structure of the content and stuff like that, they're going to go to search over and over and over again to find what they're looking for.
Yeah. So the in-app search design, you saw that it's possible now. You saw it in the reading list and in the mail app, and they looked a bit different because the colors of the buttons, for instance, were different. Yeah. So you can style the app that it's really part of the branding of your app. And just by implementing the search box control, the user gets a very familiar way of finding that information inside of your app. And we also want to think of the design of the results page, and we'll have some slides about that as well, because it doesn't end with just entering the search query. It's also very good to think about how you will present the results to the user. Now, the search box control, this is the fastest way to implement in-app search. Just include the control in your app and hook it up with the code you need to provide that information and links and etc. It's a very fast way to do. If you already had the search contract implemented in Windows 8, it's very easy to step over to using the search box control, because the interface is almost the same. So you can very easily change that to the in-app control. And you have the flexibility to make search very fast. So things like the type ahead, but also a very familiar experience for the user. They can do it in Windows, they can just start typing and find their information, and they can do it in your app as well. And of course, you can make use of all the efficiency features in Windows 8, things like suggestions, type to search, etc. Now, this is the search box control, or this is how it can look like. And when you see the drop-down there, the first is the search history. It turns out that people, when they use search to go to specific information, they will probably use that search query the next time again. So in this case, they were searching for Jake Sabulski. No idea who he is, but someone searched for it. And he found that information. So in this case, this is probably and schedule app for a convention or something like that. So somebody used this, found that information, and the next time he opens up the app, he wants to get to that information again. But the only thing he knows is he used search to get there. So what the search box control does is just show the search history of the last few searches. So it's very easy to just type the J. The option is already there, and you can very fast get to that information. So that's built into the control, and you can just use that as well. The next part of it are the result suggestions. So this is more logic inside of your app. If someone starts typing some things, you know what the user is looking for, maybe specific products or specific in sessions, or you know what it's about. And what could be probably the best result suggestions for this user. This is not a very long list, but it's the same as you see in Windows. There are a few apps shown there with those letters in it, or in this case, some sessions. So this is also a way for a user to go to the results without showing the result page. It's just in that dropdown. And the next part of it is the query suggestions. So these are just things that are through the Bing API can be offered. This is just some text that's often used to do searches. This is just to help for a very fast search experience. You can just select it and search for JavaScript or for Jen Nelson. Now, if you have suggestion types, always put the results suggestions above the query suggestions. So use this sequence, because the top one, the result suggestions, those are probably the best bets for that user to find the information he's looking for. And after that, use the other suggestions. And if you have different types of suggestions, use separators. So for instance, if you're looking for something and you can surface artists and albums and songs, group them together and differentiate it by using separators in between. So the user knows, oh, these are the artists, these are the albums, and these are the songs that I can select then. So he knows what it means, what the type of information is.
And I think you made a really solid point there too when you were talking about, you know, those first suggestions, the result suggestions. This is something my app knows about. It's like a direct hit in the search. And when I'm designing, I'm kind of differentiating between like the data that my app knows about and things you could search for in my app, which is like the query suggestions. So it's like those first examples, like sessions that are a direct hit that'll take you directly to the page versus the one like JavaScript where it would search the app and show me a results page that I could start like filtering and narrowing down on. But it is something that, when we talk about that fast and efficient, whatever I can do to get my users to exactly what they're using or looking for as quickly as possible so they can complete that scenario that they were looking to complete. Yeah, I mean, it's something we need as designers need to think about to get them successfully through that scenario and that flow to get them to the point where they've completed that thing they wanted to complete.
And it's not, so on one hand, it looks very complicated. So what is the best guess or the best suggestion now for the user to show there? But that's what you know when you build your app, because you have the knowledge of the type of content that is there and what's important for the user. And of course, you have your core scenarios there as well. So you know which scenarios are important, and so also what data is important and where the user wants to go through to. Okay, the type to search. So this is just from typing anywhere in your app, just to start searching, as we saw, for instance, in the reading list. This is best to be used on landing pages and result pages, so you can do the query or re-query and do just a very fast search. There's an easy property on the control that you can use, focus on keyboard input. Just set it to true, and it works. You have your type to search working for you. Just be sure that you don't use it in cases where you have more input fields on your screen, because then the user will get really annoyed by just typing. And suddenly he's typing in search. Instead, he was typing in the text field, right? He doesn't understand what's happening. So type to search. Filter down to a handful of results in a few key presses. So if you can narrow down the results, as we saw in the reading list app, where I just used the C and the A and the R just to filter down the results, that feels great, because you see immediately the results and you know you can find it much, much faster. But when you do this, the filtering must be very responsive. So it must be fast enough. So otherwise, when I go to the reading list again, and it would do a web query now when I do a C, and I have to, in this case, it's very fast, but then it would wait for the result, and then it will show up. And then I go A, and then we'll go web query, and it will show the result. We'll wait again, and then I type in the R, and oh yeah, there it is, the result, then it's not fast and efficient anymore, because the user is actually waiting for the response of the app. So you don't want that to happen. So make sure it's very responsive. On the other hand, if you can filter in local content, don't make it too fast, because if you start typing and it starts flashing all the time because it's redrawing the list or the information, it's not that easy on the eyes for the user. So try to be somewhere in between. And maybe you need some lag there before you execute the filtering in your app.
Yeah, just having a local index and having just a little bit of timing in there to make it as fast as possible, but not make it as fast as possible so it feels like the data is local, even if it's not, like maybe even like returning result, like having local indexing for like result suggestions and stuff like that, and then doing the loop once people say, okay, this is the, you know, the query suggestion I want, or the result suggestion, then doing the loop.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's It's an addictive feature. Like in reading list, I tag all the articles and stuff that I want to read, you know, on the web or from other apps. And I'm just so used to that on the start screen in reading list. And every time I find an app that has that, it just, it's an addictive feature. It's because it's so satisfying. It's like, I want to find, you know, all of the JavaScript articles that I save and stuff like that.
It's so easy. Yeah, indeed. And it's also a nice feature that in Windows 8.1, you can make use of the Windows indexer without having files on the disk. So that was a trick we did before.
Right.
Just put files on the disk with information there so you can find it and then translate it to maybe a query back into the database or to a web service. Now you can really use the Windows indexer without those files and just ingest information there that can be found very easy as well. So those are tricks to have things like this working for the user. But again, it's all to make users help get to their answer very fast.
Yeah.
Now, clearing the search history. As I mentioned before, the first one is the search history that's in the drop-down of the search box control. That's all being taken care of by the operating system, but provide users a way to clear that history. There might be all kinds of reasons why they want to clear that history, because they did a number of searches and they're not interested in it anymore and it just pops up. Or there are some other reasons why they want to clear that search history. So provide something in the settings to just have a button there to do the clear history. And what you see here on the screen is the API call you have to do, and the history is removed from the system. So that's also very user-friendly to implement in your app. Now, search box predictability is very important. It always should be very fast and efficient, but it should always behave in the same way. So what's important to have a consistent positioning throughout the app. Position it by default is in the top right for right to left UI. So if you have like Arabic right to left, then it's on the top left corner. But that's the standard place for search. Of course, there are reasons to put it somewhere else, as we saw with the mail app.
Right.
It's on top of the inbox. That's not because there was no more room, but it's because it gives an understanding to the user. If you start searching, it's searching in the mail, in the inbox, in all those mails, and not in the mail itself or maybe in the folders or whatever. So think about things like that as well. And also put search on every page whenever possible. So it's accessible to the user on every page, and it's really part of the system, like it's in Windows as well. I can just go to the charms and start searching. Then it's very predictable for the user.
And it's kind of like that navigation bar that we were talking about yesterday, where the navigation bar, having that on every screen, it's like I get that confidence and that security that wherever I am in the app, if I want to go someplace else in the app, I drag from the top and navigation's there. It's the same thing for search. It is really a type of navigation where it's like, okay, I'm looking at like this album or artist or something in my music app, and oh no, that's not what I was looking for. I wanted this playlist or whatever. I should just be able to, you know, click up there if it's a list page, just start typing and get that search experience. I shouldn't have to think about where can I go to do search.
Yeah.
I should just be able to think, I want to search and I search.
Exactly. Yeah. So another good thing to use is a placeholder text, and this already provides context for the user what the search results will be if that's narrowed in the functionality you offer. So for instance, in this case, this is the sports app. And on the top right, you see the search box control there. And you see it says, enter a team or player name. So, you know, it doesn't make sense to enter a league name there or maybe some other sports or just anything. The results from searching through the search box will give you teams and players. So it's already something that's predictable for the user. So he knows what the result will be of his query. And in this case, this is what we mentioned with the mailbox or the mail app, where the search box is on top of the inbox. And that is there to just find information in your inbox and not just in email or in folders, etc. Adapting the search box is also something you need to think about. So for instance, let me go to the finance app. Over there, it was still there. Let's go to today. And you see search is here, and when I open it, it's a small search box, or when I just go back and start typing, it's there, right? So that's very easy. But now when I move the app over here, it's still very small control. Maybe even if I make the app a bit smaller, when I start searching now, it takes up the complete header of the page. So there's a different experience of that same control there. But it's really part of the experience, and it makes use of that window size that we talked about yesterday in the windowing session. So this is also something to think about. This is not by default in the search box control. It's something you need to do yourself, but just putting a button there and just hiding and unhiding the search box control. And this is a very easy way to use that as well.
And I think that's something like yesterday when we were talking about core scenarios in that narrow or that tall mode. I mean, search is really, it's a core scenario, right? If people don't have a great search experience, they're not going to be able to find what they were looking for, what they wanted to do in the app. And yeah, always having that, just like the app bars we showed yesterday and saying, okay, what are the core scenarios that have to be on the app bar or the app doesn't make sense in that smaller window? I think search could easily be considered one of those core scenarios that always has to work well and always has to be super fast and super efficient, regardless of whether, I'm 320 pixels or 500 or full screen, right?
Yeah, it stays important. If you have search in your app, make sure it's predictable in use and very good accessible by the user. Now, using a search glyph in Windows 8 apps. So in Windows 8, we talked about the search contract and implementing that so you can go to the search pane through the charms and just start searching there, and it will search in your app. Now, what's with the search glyph? Now, if you're not planning a major update soon to integrate that in-app search instead of the search contract, using a glyph is a very good way to help your app now to focus on search and have a very good experience there. And let me show you why. When I go to the sports app again. When I open up the search pane now, you see it still says everywhere. I don't know if you can search in the sports app from here. No, that's the wrong example. Let me use another one. Do you know an app where you can search from the? So
I think it's news is one of them.
News. Let me just try it. News. And go to the search pane. No.
Okay.
So if the app implements the search contract, it will show up here under web videos. So you can scope to that app. I have another one that is a good idea. It's the cookbook app. There it is. So open up the cookbook. And when I open this one, it's okay. So when I go to the search charm here, you see it still scopes to everywhere because that's the default behavior. When I open it up, there's cookbook. So I first have to do this. Now I can start typing for a recipe for something with potato or something. And it will show up the results here. Now what they've done here is that there's a search glyph here on the page. So you see search at the top right and the glyph. When I tap that, it just opens up the search pane and it immediately scopes to cookbook, so to the app. So that's the way to use the search pane, but still have the scoping immediately to the app. So this is just done by adding a search glyph in your app or a button. So you open up the search pane and it's scoped to your app, to searching in your app. So how do you do that? There's a symbol in the Sago UI symbol font that you can use. The character is 94 and you're well helped by that in Windows 8.1 as well. So you can very easily include that from that font. And what you do there when you hit that button, you just execute this line of code that's below here. So it will open up the search pane and it's scoped to your app. It's that easy. So it's just that bit more easy for the user to use the search contract that's already implemented in your app.
Yeah, and if they're used to that search pane, it's going to work exactly the same, right?
Yeah.
It's kind of a good stepping stone towards moving towards like a true in-app search integration with the search box.
Yeah. So now we have entering the search. We have the possibility there with the search box control, but now we also want to think about the design of the search results page. Now, the search results page is also something that helps the user to find the information he or she was looking for. So there are a few tips that you can use to provide information to the user so it's easy to know what the search query was or where there isn't any kind of information. For instance, use the query text as title, so the user knows he typed in something, just pressed enter, now the results page is there and nothing is there. He's like, so why not? If the title includes the search query, he sees that he mistyped a word, for instance. So that's a very good way to provide information. Also try to think of indicating the ranking of the results. So maybe it's like today and yesterday and last week and things like that. Or maybe it's sorted in some other way. Provide information that the user can understand what the importance is of the various items and why they are more to the right or to the left, so he can make a good a selection of those items. Another good tip is to highlight matching search results. So especially when you show text of content or attributes of the items you found, if you can highlight that text in those items, then the user immediately knows where to look for. So if there's an abstract, for instance, and that word is highlighted, it makes more sense to him because he sees what the context of that item is. So it's an easier selection there. And also very important, align the result research to your brand and make it beautiful, like we saw in the smart search, for instance. It was a lot of eye for detail there. So when you want to do result page design, provide at-a-glance information. So not just the title of the items or just the name of the products or just the headlines of the articles, because that might not be enough information for the user to make the right selection. So if you provide more information there, where a user can see at a glance what it is, he can make a more informed decision. So show those details and also pay attention to how you expect the user to scan the results. So now the results are laid out on the page. Where will the user look at to find the items that he is looking for? And also move beyond the results in a grid. So think of other ways to present data so we can zoom into that information and find the specific information. Now, this is an example of an app that's here for an event. There's a search here done for Windows Phone, and you see there are all these blocks here with session information. So there's a Windows Phone introducing app development and et cetera. So the problem with this is the information is here, but if the first one is not the one I'm looking for, so what's the next best one for me as a user? It's very hard to find. And that's very good illustrated by the Bing search app that was there in Windows 8. That had that same concept. So when you searched, it just showed the blocks here. And of course, we have some kind of sequence here for the result. But what you see here is an eye-tracking study. So you see the big circles are where users looked, and then the line is where they look next. Now you see there's a big concentration with the first item, and that's logical. We start looking the first one at the top on the left. But then the next one, they're all over the place. They're in the second or the third, or they go more to the right or to the bottom. So there's no structure here where the users know what to expect from this sequence. This is one of the first prototypes for the new search, smart search results. And again, an eye tracking study where people got a specific medical term and had to find a definition for it. And here you see that the people were looking at the second one in this case, where they saw the picture and the title and some information there, so they knew this must be the information. So it shows they're not all over the place. There's an immediate focus on the item they think is best for this kind of information.
That was funny. If you look at that prior pages, it was just, you know, title and a grid, and it was hard even just looking at that, and I know the results and I know this example because we've talked about it in the past. I mean, it was hard for me to kind of discern between the different items which one might be the one that I'm looking for.
Exactly.
But just adding little bit of layout, like adding a photo and making the font for the title a little bit larger, and then adding enough detail that I can tell, is that the thing that I'm looking for? It really enables scanning. It really helps people get to that result as quickly as they can.
Yeah. And this is an eye tracking study they did with the results as showed now in Smart Search. And you see that the people are really going. So in this case, he is going from the first item, he scans the title and the image, and then goes to the next one and see the title and the image. And this goes on and on and on. He just starts scrolling and goes from item to item. That means that we have a good layout where the user really understands what the sequence is. And there is a way to investigate what that kind of information is, so he can make an informed decision of which item to choose. Now, again, this is the example again. How can we improve this one to have a better result for the user so he can find the information? This is a way to do that in this case. So now they split it up in days and in morning and in afternoon. So let's say I'm doing this query in Thursday afternoon. I see that there are no Windows Phone session, so I'm done immediately. Or when I do this on a Friday morning, I see there are four sessions to choose from. So still, all the information is there, but there's more structure in the information. So it's easier for the user to determine which item is best for his query. So that's a way to do that. Of course, it depends on the kind of data and the structure of it and what makes sense to the user. And then you can also have things like being done in Smart Search, where all that information is there. It's laid out very beautiful. There's really a lot of experience here. You see San Francisco, there's information, there's some attractions, and you can go to the links. There's really put a lot of thought in this information, how to lay it out and make it beautiful for the user and still provide the information the user is looking for. So if we see what we've talked about in this session, a search must be very fast and efficient because you want to provide a very fast answer to the user so he can find his information. We've seen Smart Search, part of the Windows, is a very fast and efficient search across Windows and the web, so you can find that kind of information. We've seen that you can find the apps and you can find files and et cetera, and the web links. So it's a very good use of that. When you want to have that same one in your app, use the search box control, and to provide an in-app search and have that same kind of functionality there. And also think of the design the result page and design that. Make sure it's good to read. There's a good structure there, so the user knows where to look and what to do with that. If you want to do a lab on this for your own app, start brainstorming for search scenarios. That's important for your app and the core scenarios in your app. So think of what will people search for and what is important information to make them help focus on that content. Think about also the query suggestions, for instance. Also, design a search result page. Think of how you will lay out that information on the page so a user can really get that, know what they can find and get them very fast to their answer. And also think of suggestions that you can give, like query suggestions or result suggestions. What's an easy way to provide it to the user in combination with the search box control? There are some resources here on the Design Center. There are guidelines and a checklist for using search in your apps. And also on the Dev Center, there are various quick starts and samples that you can use to implement search in your apps. Now, there are a few questions. Can you customize Smart Search and restrict only for intranet enterprise companies for high security internal applications? So Smart Search uses Bing Search. So that means when you go through that, you always go to the web and what Bing crawled on the web. So it cannot see information that's inside an organization. So there's at this moment no way to integrate that kind of information in the Smart Search. So the best solution is to have a very good in-app search and use that functionality to search in your app and provide that information. The second question is, in Windows 8, the search charm allowed for searching across apps. The current behavior in 8.1 uses Bing for all searches for charms. Can you speak to these changes from a usability perspective and share some of the thinking behind it? Yeah, so the scoping that was there to search in apps was only used by a few people. And most of the people, I think it was like 93 or 94% of the people, never used that. So and also app builders were a bit... so it was very easy to step out of your app and go to another app to find the information where you might have the same information in your app. So that's why they changed it in Windows, to provide a very fast and efficient experience for the user to find the information most of them are looking for. And that's always the problem when you make software for like a zillion people, right? Make it adapt for every scenario. But most people used it like that, so that's why it changed. And well, that's the way to do it, to have it implemented in your app.
That was something, I was actually talking with the search team early on in Windows 8 when we were talking about this feature change, and it was one of those things that you would use the contract, as a user, you would use the contract and do the search in your app, and then it was almost like, well, you had to sit there and click on the different apps, you know, hoping that there would be a result that would be what you were looking for. And what I really like about Smart Search is it kind of turns that around and puts the onus or the responsibility on Windows and Bing to show you the apps that are going to have pertinent results for that search. So if I type in San Francisco, it's going to show me Wikipedia, it's going to show me the travel app, and so on. So I don't have to, as the user, like, you know, go on a treasure hunt to try and find the results I'm looking for. Bing just shows me, here are the apps that have, you know, direct results for San Francisco, which is the one that you want. So it's a from a usability standpoint, it's a great story, right?
Right. So another question is, does the search box control support regular expression type search? By default, it does not. But you'll implement the search yourself. Because so it goes through an API where a search hits your code and you... decide what the search does, right? Mm-hmm. Is it going out to a web search or a database or maybe a few web requests? So it's up to you to implement the text that's coming in there. But the thing is with regular expressions, don't make it too complicated for the user because they might not understand what they can do. So it could be very complex for the user. But there is a way to do that. Another question, is remove search history functionality available in the default Windows 8.1 search box while not inside an app?
Yeah. Remove. I just did it. I typed in search, and it gave me search settings, and there's a big button that says clear search history.
Yeah. Okay. So, So you can do it not inside the app as well to clear that, clear the history as well.
Yeah, across the whole system.
Yeah. Right, it's always across the whole system. Yeah. Is voice search a good user experience? It depends if you're sitting next to that guy and he's talking all the time to his PC, I guess. It can be a very good experience, especially when you don't have your hands free in doing the search. So maybe with a mobile environment, then it's very handy to just talk to the system and to get the results. Then it might be very useful. I think it depends on where you're using it and what kind of scenario you're thinking of. Okay, that's it for now. We already went some time over. We'll have a short break of 10 minutes, and we'll be back with the next session on Share. So thanks for watching.
Thanks.